The most music. Music. Every hour. Ready, set, let's roll. Ready, set, let's ride. Get you to be online at the end of the tour.
All right, all right, all right.
Ladies and gentlemen,
this is the greatest station
in the country.
All right.
All right.
Awesome.
Awesome.
Low Country Radio, the good time and good music radio station. We've got your sports, we've got your good times, and we've got your music.
Your favorite.
Right here on Low Country Radio. Tune us in.
The cats win big, and so should you. For 13 years at Exclusive Engravings on Ford Avenue, Chris and LaShonda Hartley have a wide range of gifts, trophies, executive awards, home accessories, custom apparel, and more. A veteran-owned business, Chris and LaShonda have served our country, and now they're ready to serve you. Trust local, shop local. Stop by to see Chris and LaShonda today. And oh yeah, Chris is a proud Batesburg-Leesville High School grad in South Carolina, just like Charlie Moon and longtime Richmond Hill teacher Sarah Goldrick.
The only time Bobby Boucher on the V, quarterback wrong, you're a famous young one, Bobby Boucher, dying.
Get this bottle to respond to it, because I don't know anything more than that. I told you everything I know. So you can ask the bottle, but don't ask me.
It's almost time.
Bears are who we thought they were.
The Matt Lezotte Show.
If you want to crown them, then crown their ass.
On LowCountryRadioSports.com.
They are who we thought they were, and we let them off the hook.
Sponsored by Exclusive Engravings and Papa's Pizza.
Playoffs? We'll talk about it. Playoffs? You kidding me? Playoffs? I just hope we can win a game.
Come on now. Just sit back, relax, and hear from the coach.
We couldn't do diddly poo offensively. We couldn't make a first down. We couldn't run the ball. We didn't try to run the ball.
Sponsored by Exclusive Engravings and Papa's Pizza.
We couldn't complete a pass.
And don't forget the BBB, the baddest baldies in the biz, Moody Brock. Get up off your feet now and give me more cowbell.
I gotta have more cowbell.
You too, Tim Melhorn and Freddie Howell. I'll see you in your living room. He's shaking a groove, man. You too, Riverboat Rock. And you too, Coach Matty Lezotte. Live from Papa. Sponsored by Exclusively Gravy. This time, a Wildcat Nation and the Matt Lezotte Show.
What's going on, Wildcat Nation? Having a good time. Locked up on the inside here at Papa's Pizza. You know, we first were looking for a venue, and we ended up talking to John and Mary Cave about doing it here. We debated on doing it inside or outside, and there were some pluses and minuses. Either way, outside has worked great for us, especially we got some new plans that are going to start next week that will hopefully get some more folks out. We'll talk about that later. But we're inside tonight, because Mother Nature is still spitting out some water like it did last week. How's it going, Coach Matt Lezotte? We got Matt Lezotte in the house with us. How's it going, Coach?
You know, we've had a great practice. Got a little wet out there today, but we were able to have a great indoor practice.
These guys ready to go Friday night?
Okay, you know what? I'm going to backtrack here live on air. Start back over where you just started. I got my mic switched up a little bit here for a couple different reasons. Coach Lezotte, how's it going tonight?
No, it's good. We've had a great week of practice, big Monday and Tuesday, and then today we were indoors in the gym, but those guys got a lot of great looks, and man, we're getting ready, getting nice and oiled up, ready to perform Friday night.
Talk about that that indoor facility. I mean, you know, it serves so many different purposes. I mean, just talk about that process.
Well, I tell you what, you know, and there was a group of folks walking through today. You know, we'll finally get that turf laid down here coming shortly. And you know, we see so much inclement weather here in the fall and the spring. It's going to provide a place, an opportunity for folks to go prepare. Our seniors a couple years ago, we tallied it up. They missed a season's worth of practice over the course of their 4 years. And for you folks at home that don't understand how important football practice is, it's it's one of the few sports that you practice as much as you do and play as little as you play. And I tell you what, missing out on that preparation, it has an effect on the development of the athletes, and hopefully we can curb that with the new indoor facility when the turf gets down.
When that turf gets down, would that play any difference in the coaching style? Playing on turf compared to grass, is there any?
Well, not really. Okay. You know, it's more of an even playing field. Has a little more to do maybe in the place kicking game, but as far as play goes, our guys like just getting out there and going. It doesn't matter grass or turf. You know, the guys are ready to go. You got to prepare for any type of turf burn should you fall down, but that ain't fun.
Yeah.
But no, it's
or
it's
turf
just,
toe.
Yeah, I know, but you know, it's just. Well, I prefer turf over natural surface because it's a lot more durable.
Okay.
You know, less maintenance. You don't have to worry about it getting cut or lined or the water, the mud that comes along with the rain. That's a big factor. We went up and visited Burke County a few years ago, and it was raining during the summer, and we were watching them practice, and like there was nothing going on. You know, it was like it was a dry practice out there, and I was so envious of them and the time that they don't miss compared to the time that we do, and looking forward to being able to do it in the future.
Yeah, if that game Friday night played on Astro turf, I think y'all get the win. But anyway, that was a quagmire Friday night.
Yeah, it got nice and muddy. Nice and muddy. And it was only rain cloud in South Georgia. So
yeah, it come out of nowhere. When you come out the locker room, you had to think like, wow, it's raining.
No, I was in the locker room. I was like, man, let me check on my weather app real quick and see when this thing's going to pass. And it said, it'll pass about 10 o'clock. I said, right on time for this game to finish up. Right on time.
So, right on time. You know, thank you, Mr. Weatherman.
The great equalizer in sports is the weather.
Yeah.
And it sure played a role Friday night. But, you know, our guys know that if we want to play better, if we want to win games, we've got to block and tackle better. And we can't turn the ball over. And we do those things. We get better doing those things. We're going to be just fine.
Well, we're going to take a short break, and we come back. We're going to dig into Friday night's game, and later on we'll talk to our Low Country Radio players of the games. We'll obviously come back after the break. We'll review that quagmire from the other night and have some audio highlights run with it and talk to Coach Lezotte and get his insight in some of those plays. Then our players of the games. And later on in the show, we got a couple special guests that are going to join us on air from wherever they are in this world. I'm just going to leave it like that. Going to have a good time with that because this week is Military Appreciation Week. We're going to talk about our really cool fundraiser that we're going to kick off here in the next couple days. So stay with us. You're listening to the Coach's Show, sponsored by Exclusive Engravings. We're coming to you live from Papa's. We'll be right back.
Quality Contracting, 912-656-0968. When Noah sails the ark through your yard, call Robbie Oglesby with A-plus Quality Contracting for all your seamless gutter and roofing needs. Opening our doors in 2004, we offer over 30 years of experience, and we promise we're going to treat you right. We love our community and are proud sponsors of several RHHS sports programs. Mention you heard our ad on Low Country Radio and get 10% off a full home gutter installation. Call 912-656-0968 or see us at aplusquality.biz. That's aplusquality.biz.
912-656-0968. So I'm telling the Duke where he and brother Tony helped lead JMU to a 2004 natty. The kids, they call him Ah. Come on, Dad. And Lindsay, hey, honey, on your way home, pick up the tab. Lean in close. There's more to this story. When he left the Dukes, Lezotte followed his dream of raising young men, and that's not all he lifted. Aquinas High of Augusta, Georgia was in no shape for the reverence of Amen Corner. 8 years later, as an OC and strength man, a Matty boy was fitted for a green jacket on demand. Lezotte fired up the Aquinas fairway drivers and turned the corner to a GA private power. 36.9 points per game. Come on, that just ain't right. And then 2 years of OC and Wayne, the trip to the state title game, you knew somebody was going to say, hey, what's that guy's name? In 2015, the Hell came a-calling, and Lezotte said, let's go balling. Hey, Lindsay, hey, kids, come on, guys. We're packing up our bags for Richmond Hill High, but hang on. The story's just not quite done yet. You see, the Cats have been pretty good before 2019, but now there's a depth like never before from seniors with
with good old, big old GBA. The big old freshman lineman that just eat big old raw steak. Since then, it's been all about building the hill in 2019. And there was this moment that finally gave rise for Richmond Hill to that big time feel.
And we've got one timeout because Richmond Hill, we're not going to use it now. I'm just letting the listeners know. It's third down and four here at the 31-yard line. We're hanging on to a 16-14 lead. Rodemaker, he gives to Robinson, and he stuck in the backfield.
Jordan Clark.
Jordan Clark, how do you do? You have to stand up now. It's fourth and seven from their own 36, and they do now. The Richmond Hill crowd rises. Rodemaker, he drops back, and he's covered over there, and the ball is knocked away
Jordan
by a deer.
Again.
Jordan Clark, he was trying to find Sherman, and Jordan Clark came in right in front of the student section that was here at 6 o'clock tonight.
No timeouts left. I mean, one first down.
You tell Joe Fusel, Jeremiah Coleman, Corey Riley, Bodie Truax, and Caleb Tanner, you tell those guys up front, hey, go get a first down.
The center's over the ball to snap. He hands it off to Jalen. Jalen scoops through for a first down. We got a first down and some. Ball's going to be placed on about the 48, 49-yard line. They're going to move to change. Citizens Bank first down. Richmond Hill.
Freddie, you have fun with this last minute and 45. Because
awesome.
I know you got to love it, buddy. Have fun with this, Freddie Howell. You, Freddie Howell, take
man,
it away, buddy.
I believed at the beginning of the season, I told Tim Melhorn, Charlie Moon, the Richmond Hill Wildcats.
Hey, I got your boy, Nathan Vick.
I've never been anything part of this before.
Is that Freddie? I think you got Tim.
I've been on the ground crying. Brother, man, it's been a pleasure listening to you all night long. Y'all got a bunch of Louisiana people tripping out around here. Valdosta goes down to the mighty Richmond Hill Wildcats.
Show them Raging Cajun's house done in Louisiana.
Now, Matt Lezotte wants to forget about the time on his senior day at JMU. And now, starting quarterback is three-letterman Matt Lezotte. Come on now, the JMU Jumbotron had his brother Tony's face on it. I told you I'd get you, Coach. So, strap it up, folks. Get your ears on. It's time. The Wildcat Nation and the Matt Lezotte Show.
I would say that's champagne, but that's Gatorade being through everywhere over there.
How perfect to end that intro song with old Freddie Howell, the voice of Freddie Howell, talking about champagne and Gatorade being thrown everywhere. That was a glorious night, and folks are going to hear that a lot. And Coach, I'm not one of those guys that always like to rest on laurels and remember this great time, and that's the only great time. But for that... Whoa, hold on now. It decided. Hey, it was so good. It decided. The radio boss gods are messing with us there a little bit. But, you know, hey, what a magical night that was. And, that's one of the beauties of a sports broadcast. And as long as you record it correctly, hey, you get to have those memories forever. So it's pretty awesome to have that. Let's go ahead and dig into the Statesboro game a little bit. Somewhat a story, two different stories, not quite first half, second half. You can split it up into two segments however you want to. First half, second half. There were two different stories because the rain was second half. But then, Brock, it seemed like, and we talked about it, Kalen Michael, one of the brothers, one of that combo, him and Jalen, we knew they were going to be good, and they were. Kalen Michael, he started off in that first quarter and a half. He was averaging, Chip Porter, awesome student intern, did a great job of taking care of stats. In the first quarter and a half, he was averaging 17 and a half, 18 yards a carry. But that changed a ton from that point on. Real quickly, before we start diving into some specific plays, talk about what you guys did on defense, after Mr. Michael. I mean, he tore it up. He showed his athleticism for the first 16 minutes, but you guys made some adjustments after that.
We sure did. And I tell you, in hearing the 2019, the clips from 2019 and the experiences that we had, the adjustments that we made, how good we've gotten at making adjustments under that tent on the sideline. Tremendous coaching staff, tremendous ability to communicate to the guys, our players' ability to adapt and figure it out and believe in it and trust it. Watching Coach Blanton and Coach Lezotte together on the sideline, and me staring at them like guys, we got to do something, and those guys finding an answer. It was something special, and you know what, we we've done that over the years where it's taken a little bit to get the juices flowing and get going and I was proud of the way our guys responded and it really competed to the very end.
Here's the play. We were down 7-0 in the second quarter. And it ended with a touchdown drive. We'll have that highlight in just a second. But here's a play that kept that play going. And we'll talk to this young man later. One of our POGs, Hayden McCullough, with a big catch here. 10:50 to go here. 7-0. We need a first down. Play action. Over the middle. Finding Hayden nice. McCullough. Hey, guys, get your paint cans ready. Hayden McCullough's dancing in the end zone. Color
there goes
me.
A nice high punt by Gilbert Brown under pressure. They hit him in the backfield.
Guys, you know, right there, Hayden McCullough with a big catch over the middle, pitch and catch from Ty Goldrick.
Well, I tell you, we've done a very good job over the last month or so, really starting to get that mesh between these guys, not only on the perimeter, but also in the backfield. And you can see our guys' production changing and the flow of the game and their belief in one another. To be where they're supposed to be, when they're supposed to be there, do what they're supposed to do when the ball gets there, getting the ball there, doing the pass pro to make sure that they can get it there. Everything really kind of meshing together. We've gotten a lot better of it in the last month. A lot of that has to do with our guys growing up.
Yeah, and then we'll fast forward to about the five-minute mark of the second quarter, getting closer to halftime, and that's about the time when you guys kind of began to take control of the ball game. I mean, we know it didn't end up in a win, but for such a large percentage of the game, after you guys made your adjustments, I mean, for the most part, except for Mother Nature, and we'll talk about Mother Nature in a minute, except for Mother Nature deciding she was going to, have a great effect on the ball game, we had plays like this.
Come out, little Wildcat there. Easterling, hey, Wildcat Nation. I don't see any flags. Guess what you're going to have to do? You're going to have to get your paint cans ready. Color me six. Easterling with the score.
Boy, Richmond Hill needed that.
Untimely in our own territory. You take a look at the course of the season, our defense. And I asked them Monday, I said, guys, what's the difference between us starting right here in our own territory or over there in their own territory? You know, we're just playing defense. It's 11 on 11. Like, what's the difference? And a lot of it has to do with attitude and mentality. And our guys got to show up with a little bit of an edge when you're backed up. Like, that's when you really get hot. That's when you really start to turn it out. And we've got to do a better job of doing that and showing up with that mentality, because we play really good defensive ball when they start on their end. Visiting teams or opposing teams, they punt the ball a lot when they start on that half, but on the flip side of things, they score a lot when they start on our half. So that's been a big focus of ours, and hoping that our guys are going to really turn it up and play hard, regardless of the location, the starting point of the ball. We just got to go out there and give them three downs and let them decide what they want to do.
So both squads go in at halftime, tied 14-14. We took a short commercial break. We come out, we'll talk about the second half.
The Cats win big, and so should you. For 13 years at Exclusive Engravings on Ford Avenue, Chris and LaShonda Hartley have a wide range of gifts, trophies, executive awards, home accessories, custom apparel, and more. A veteran-owned business, Chris and LaShonda have served our country, and now they're ready to serve you. Trust local, shop local. Stop by to see Chris and LaShonda today. And oh yeah, Chris is a proud Batesburg-Leesville High School grad in South Carolina, just like Charlie Moon and longtime Richmond Hill teacher Sarah Goldrick.
And we're back on LowCountryRadio.com. I'm Charlie Moon alongside Brock Vanet. You're listening to Wildcat Nation and the Matt Lezotte Show, sponsored by, powered by, our folks right across the parking lot, actually. Chris and LaShonda Hartley at Exclusive Engravings, and the folks right here, John and Mary Cave at Papa's Pizza. Man, I'm running. We're having a little bit shorter show tonight because I'm hungry. I want to give me some of that caveman a little bit.
Hey, you got to ask Zimbalotti how the caveman was last week.
Oh, yeah. We're going.
No, I'm talking about Mr. Zimbalotti.
Okay. All right. I'll get to that. Yes, sir. We'll talk some eating in a little while. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Right now, we'll go to this second half. We had a 19-yard touchdown pass with about 6.5 minutes to go.
queuing it up. Here we go. I believe this was Ryan Grant's third touchdown of the ball game. Time out of the break for the snap here. He's got Ryan Steele in motion from the 19-yard line. Goldrick fakes the give on the jet sweep. He's looking for a man over the middle of the post pattern, and Ravon Grant makes the catch at the 4-yard line, slips the tackle, wheels around, and hey, folks, in your end zone, in your driveways, at your cookouts, get your paint cans ready. Color me six. Whoa, baby.
Ty, do you remember that play?
What was it?
Oh, see?
It was Ryan Grant, the post pattern touchdown pass for you. I completed to him from the 19-yard line, the third quarter, to make it 21-21.
You remember that play, Ravon?
I mean, Ravon, what did I say?
You said Ryan.
Did I say Ryan?
Yes, sir.
You said Ryan. Okay.
Don't worry.
Okay, I got you. Okay. Okay, Ravon,
yeah,
take it.
I do remember it now. All right. I was like, Ryan Grant. I had to
take us through the play. What's the play call first? Can he say that?
Oh, yeah. It's
all right, go.
Triple blue licks.
Huh?
It was an RPO.
Okay, that's fair enough.
Okay, so it was an RPO. So that was one of those read and react kind of plays.
Yeah.
Reading we got kind of plays, and you know, with the defense you guys are going to be playing.
It's called the annexation of Puerto Rico.
Annexation. That's pretty good. Hey, we get messages from some folks. That, let's just say, they like to listen to these coaches' shows because you never know what they might be able to pick up. So we try to be careful about what we talk about and what we ask and that kind of thing, because you never know. I mean, you never know what somebody might be able to pick up from just somebody's local podcast, or because this is, I mean, this airs live now, but it's also downloaded as a podcast, and it'll go up either late tonight, unless that caveman pizza puts me to sleep before I get home, or one way or the other, be up tomorrow night. But anyway, yeah, that was a big time play. And, you know, Coach Lezotte, talk about that. You know, talk about. Let's just slow it down and talk about the second half a little bit when Mother Nature decided to come in. Because right at halftime, you know, and this is the second part of the story. The second half just caused havoc.
Well, you know, going into halftime, like I said, we weren't sure how long the rain was going to last. And I think Ty can attest to this, is that, you know, we checked the weather. When we walked in, we said, guys, it ain't going to stop. What are we going to do? Let's go get it. And so had a great game plan, had great adjustments coming out after half. And but like I said, you know, like it weather is the great equalizer. And sometimes it throws a little damper in things, and things that seem to be there or not, and things that don't seem to be there are, and you know, we were able to remain focused and stay dialed in, and had the ball there at the end with a chance to win, you know, especially after they missed their extra point. We felt really confident taking the field that we were going to go out there and win the football game.
When you come out at halftime, you already made your adjustments. When you come out, you see it's raining. Did y'all have to adjust on the fly any with the rain? No.
We I mean, I was, like I said, I was checking that weather app at halftime to see how long it was going to last, and saw that it was going to last. We said, hey, let's go. You know, we rotated about 20 or so footballs into the game. That's one thing. I don't ever want to lose a game because of a football.
Yeah.
And we were rotating them in now. We were rotating them in, and, you know, just trying to take that variable out of play. But you know what? Proud of our guys again. We stayed in the fight. That's all we asked them to do, and they did, and we just came up short. There's a winner and loser every Friday night.
All right. So what? But on the play, you want to play it again? He's gonna play it again. Think about what I want to know is what was going through your mind before the snap. But hold on, he's gonna play it one more time.
No, you're fine. Okay. String it out for a second. I gotta do it.
What was going through your head before that touchdown pass to Ryan Grant? What was going through your head on the RPO before the snap? What's going through your head?
You know, I was just reading my read key, and then, you know.
So you start reading before the snap?
Well, yeah, I'm always looking at the defense, just seeing what they're lined up in, so I know like where they're going to be at the time of the play. And then I guess
Wildcat
I just kind of
there, Easterling. Hey, Wildcat Nation! Guess what you're going to have to do? You're going to have to get your paint cans ready.
Color me 6, Easterling with the score.
Boy, Richmond Hill needed that.
That's what happens when you're trying to host a show, call it, and run tech at the same time. Finish your thought, Todd. Sorry.
I was just looking at the defense, and I made the wrong read. I'm not even going to lie. I guess I threw a good ball. He caught it.
Why don't you tell the people back home, what is an RPO?
It's a run-pass option.
So run-pass. If you had your choice, what would you do?
I want to pass it every single
time.
You
want to pass it? Okay. How many times have you made the wrong read on an RPO this year?
Not much.
Not much?
Not
so
much.
How many RPOs would you say y'all ran this year?
Too many.
Too
many? We run them all the time.
And you've made the right read, let's say, 90% of the time?
I'd say so.
Okay. So is that anytime Charlie and I witness a pass, is it normally an RPO? Or a run?
If we do play action, it's probably an RPO.
Okay.
If it looks like it's play action, it's probably an RPO.
All right. I got the correct one queued up. This is Hank Aaron's home run. Here we go.
Time out of the break for the snap here. He's got Ryan Steele in motion from the 19-yard line. Goldrick fakes the give on the jet sweep. He's looking for a man over the middle of the post pattern, and Ravon Grant makes the catch at the 4-yard line. Slips the tackle, wheels around, and hey, folks, in your end zone, in your driveways, at your cookouts, get your paint cans ready. Color me 6. Whoa, baby.
Yeah, and now we're going to kind of fast forward to the last drive, Coach Lezotte, and get your we're going to listen to a few plays from this last drive. They're kind of meshed together. Let's take a listen. Let's talk about it.
Goldrick rocks back. He's got some pressure.
Well, let me back up and set the stage first. We ended up in that second half, and I believe, correct me if I'm wrong, Coach Lezotte, but I believe now Statesboro lost the ball a couple times too, but I believe we lost the ball on fumbles. Was it twice? I know it was two times, or was it three times?
Three.
Okay. One
counted it as one also. So,
gotcha.
It was a little.
Gotcha. With the score tied 21-21, we ended up fumbling the ball right at the 19 or 20 yard line, and two plays later, Mr. Michael actually, and we talked about this, the only good run that he had after the halfway mark of the second quarter was the one that he scored on.
Yeah.
Well, he set up the 1 yard touchdown for his brother there late in the game. So the ball slips through our hands. They get the ball at 19. They score two plays later. And like I said on the play call, I'm not going to play that one here. But the good thing about it was they left 1:33 on the clock.
They sure did.
That's right. And we didn't end up exactly what we wanted to happen. But I think as far as the pressure situation and some weather, we got some trust knowing that we can do it. And here's a couple clips from that last drive. Let's listen to it and talk about it.
Back, he's got some pressure, looking for a man on the sidelines, and Nick Bliss, does he catch it? Yep, they're going to call it complete for a miter survey, first down at the 35-yard line, so we got plenty of Goldrick takes snap, drops back, and he had a man over the middle. Is that a one-handed catch by Tommy Bliss? I believe it is. The clock's going to move. That's the only problem with that, but it does make third down and 4 or 5 instead of 36 seconds to go here. Fourth down and 4. Here's your ball game, folks. At the 29-yard line, Gilbert or Goldrick steps up. He's in the gun. He's got Easton on his right side. Trips on that near side. That'd be McCullough, Bliss and Bliss. Nick and Tommy splitting that near hash. We still do have a couple of timeouts. Well, we've got all three. We've got two timeouts left. They're waiting on the call. They get in from the sideline. Goldrick drops back. He's looking for Ravon Grant. And Ravon Grant slipped, but he catches it. Oh, my goodness. Ravon Grant slipped coming out of his cut. But he fell down on the line drive shot to him, but he gained his feet just in time to catch it right before he landed out of bounds at his feet stadium. 30 seconds to go here. The clock's up.
And then we all know how the drive ended, actually, with just for the lack of time, and so this show doesn't last 3.5 hours. We ended up with a couple of really good teardrops thrown by Goldrick under pressure from 25, between that 25 and 30 yard line. So it's almost like the scoreboard didn't actually say what we wanted at the end, but as far as knowing that, hey, in a pressure situation at the end of the game, are we able to come through? And the answer to that is yes. I mean, I wonder how much different it would have been if Mother Nature wasn't there. That ball slips through Bliss's hands or Grant's hands there's all kinds of different scenarios. But bottom line is the trust is there. But take us through that last drive, Coach Lezotte. And, I know, again, we want to be – yeah, I, You know how to handle it. Take us through that last drive.
Well, I tell you, we got the ball back, and Coach Gray, special teams coordinator, showed the clip of the kickoff return with the game on the line today in our special teams meeting. And, you know, just talking about, hey, you know, I think we how close we finished to the goal line. You know, if we could have gotten 10 more yards, who knows what would happen if it would have busted, and how important those plays are in the kicking game, especially in those critical situations. And started the drive, did a lot of good things. We weren't flustered at all. You know, it was one of those things where as you move down the field and things, throwing and catching, moving the ball, getting out of bounds, we converted some third and fourth downs. And the big thing was that we weren't flustered. You know, when we got down there close, we saw what they were doing. We knew exactly what we wanted to do, how we wanted to do it. Coach Scott called a great game. And they've got coaches too, and they've got players. And you know, a lot of times when you get it going, the one ball right there at the end, the guy got a fingernail on it just enough to knock it away. And that's all it takes in the game of football, game of inches, you know. But I was proud of our fight. We stayed in the fight. I've said that multiple times tonight. That's been one of our mottos this year: just stay in the fight, and let's just see what happens. And our guys came back ready Monday, ready to move forward.
Yeah, that's why I couldn't put that pass play to Grant on the reel, because live on the call I sounded like a 5-year-old, you know, like he's just somebody just took his candy away from him. I was about like this right here. I was like, I don't know what to say. I described what happened. It's like, yeah, wow, Brock.
I was really impressed with y'all's clock management on that last drive, minute 33. Yeah. Y'all driving all the way down, didn't even use but one timeout. Whose job is in that situation? I know you said, what's the offensive coordinator? Joe Scott called the plays. You do the time. You do the clock management.
Yeah, I do. I do the timeouts. You know, and take a look at it, and you know, it's over the course of my career, that's one of the areas that I've really tried to improve on, about the timeliness of that, especially in those situations. Getting better at that, more experience that I get in those situations, the better I get at it. And you know, we practice those in practice. A lot of times it's scripted when we go through our 2-minute drill, but we've been very effective executing that here lately. So I wasn't surprised at all that we were moving the ball, and our guys were calm while they were doing it.
Yep.
It's not something that they're not used to doing. It's something that we're accustomed to doing as a team, and I was proud of them.
Ty, what was going through your head on that last drive, knowing that it's probably the biggest drive of your career up to this point, right?
To win the game. I mean, I just wanted to go out there and win the game.
You didn't want to take it play by play, though? I mean,
not really. It was just to go out there and win the game. I mean, I knew I had to go and execute and throw a good ball, but at the end of the day, it was just.
But you was 100%. You was going. I mean, you made all the throws.
Yeah, it was just win the game.
Okay.
It was just getting there, getting the end zone, win the game.
That's But you would have tied it, though, wouldn't you?
Yeah, I would have tied it with six, but
Aiden and company would have to come in and take care of that. But it's going to round out our discussion of the Statesboro game. Take a short commercial break. We're going to talk to some notorious POGs. We'll be right back. You're listening to the Coach's Show on LowCountryRadio.com. Sponsored by who? Exclusive Engravings.
All right, that was good.
Quality Contracting, 912-656-0968. When Noah sails the ark through your yard, call Robbie Oglesby with A-plus Quality Contracting for all your seamless gutter and roofing needs. Opening our doors in 2004, we offer over 30 years of experience, and we promise we're going to treat you right. We love our community and are proud sponsors of several RHHS sports programs. Mention you heard our ad on Low Country Radio and get 10% off a full home gutter installation. Call 912-656-0968 or see us at aplusquality.biz. That's aplusquality.biz. 912-656-0968. Let us get you covered.
Yeah, we're back on LowCountryRadio.com. You're listening to Wildcat Nation and the Matt Lezotte Show. Live from Papa's Pizza, John and Mary Cave, always doing such a great job of hosting the show and all week long supporting Richmond Hill schools, athletic programs, fine arts, academics, and actually I know a lot of Richmond Hill students, and sometimes a lot of them get their first job here. It's kind of get their feet wet in the real world, so to speak. So thanks again so much to John and Mary Kay for hosting us. And, of course, our Name Your Rights owners, Coach the Show, powered by Chris and LaShawn, the Hartley at Exclusive Engraving. But right now we've got a couple notorious POGs with us. Thomas, do you know what you graded out at the other night? You're our lineman of the game, and I know you're all your OL coach here. Coach Davis is here, so be careful about what you say. Not that I think you'd say anything wrong. I don't know. I'm just messing with you. But do you know what you graded out at the other night?
No, sir.
Okay, that's fine. That's fine. Talk. Okay. What? 90. I know you folks listen live. That's one of the good things about doing this inside. If somebody speaks from 15 feet or so, if I got the mic up loud enough, you can actually kind of hear it. So 90. So, Thomas, compare – obviously 90 is good, but compare that to getting a grade on a quiz or a test at school.
You know, it's not really different. It's just like when, like, coach is talking at practice, you got to be attentive and, like, you just put it to the game and just – like on a test, like study guide, you fill it out, you know.
Which one's more important?
Football.
There's the real question. There's the real question. I know, Jaden, you're the Low Country Radio special teams player of the game. Talk about your role in the special teams, because we talk about old Gilbert Brown all the time. I mean, the other night I had a highlight queued up for him, but just for the sake of time, didn't run it. But I mean, the other night he kicked one literally 51, 52 yards in the air, and he had three guys in his face that almost blocked the kick in a cold, wet – well, not cold, but a wet, rainy night, wet balls and everything, and he still crushed it 50 yards. So we talk about him a lot. So it's good to have Jaden Day with us, player of the game on the special teams. Talk about your role in that special teams and then your game the other night.
Yeah, I mean, I protect Gilbert, you know. I take credit for his kicks.
So you're the protector.
Yeah,
you're the protector.
Yeah.
You're the man right there. All right, awesome.
No, I'm kidding. Gilbert's a good puncher. He's really good. But, yeah, I protect Gilbert on a punt, personal protector for him. And on kickoff, I contain the edge, which last week I messed up a few times, but we're getting under control, you know. We're fixing that so we can get the defense good field position, you know. And then on kick return, I block. So
okay.
I pick up my blocks, get the offense good field position.
Well, hey, I think we've got like 117 kickoff returns for touchdowns. We got to have some kind of record in there. So you guys up front are obviously doing your job there. The other night, Statesboro, it was so wet out there. Does that change your footing, your thought process, blocking on special teams with so many bodies flying at you from different directions?
Yes, sir. I mean, the ground being wet, it does mess you up a little bit. You slip around a little bit, but, you know, you just got to play with it. You can't do anything about it, so you just got to deal with it.
Nothing you can do with it. You know, Thomas, there's another place going to be on the highlight reel later this week, probably hopefully before Friday morning, sometime tomorrow night or Friday morning, our highlight reel will come out. And one of the plays we kind of tapped was where you and one of the other offensive linemen pulled around on an old-school buck sweep. I said something about Zimbo coming around from that left side. You know, you got to love it. You got to love it when you're pulling from, you know, say the left side. In this particular play, I'm thinking it was second half because you guys were going from right to left, and you pulled from the left side around that right side. And I don't remember who else was on the offensive line pulling with you, but I joked about it. I was like, who in the world wants to be that outside linebacker, that defensive back, trying to step up with those guys coming at you? Talk about the joy of running a buck sweep like that, paving the way.
Man, I love it. It's like you get to pull, make a hole for your running back, and your running back gets to score, and you just love it, man. It's amazing when your running back runs past you and he's in the end zone, you know.
So if you're the onside guard on that play, is your job to kick or lead? Or just pick up the first odd jersey you see.
And you know, Jaden, on our special teams, tell us your thought process with a couple of your returners, Bliss and Grant, having such a good year. I mean, it's kind of a rhetorical question, but talk about your thought process when that ball goes in the air.
I'm just thinking about who I got to pick up so that they don't get to Tommy and Rayvon so they can run it back home.
Okay, now how do you make that decision? Who you picking up?
They tell us. Our coaches let us know.
That's not bad. Kudos to the coaching staff for special teams being able to eye down.
What if he ain't out there on the punt team? You block a position,
yes,
not
sir.
A man. Because
yes, sir. I pick up so there's certain numbers on kickoff and in punt. I pick up whoever's the most outside.
Okay.
On kick return, I mean, they have numbers assigned to people, and I drop back and get the
Is numbers. It complicated? Sounds kind of complicated.
It's not. It sounds complicated. Complicated, but it's not that complicated.
You ever see that old when the Detroit Lions are sitting right there pointing before, and they said, I got this guy, and all the players are up there? Talk about the importance of special teams.
Because
a lot of people. You know, I know Coach Lezotte just said he had a special teams meeting today.
Yes, sir.
I never quite had special teams meetings because all my guys play both ways, including special teams.
Yes, sir.
Talk about the importance of special teams.
I think special teams is very important because, I mean, if we give offense a good field position, less they have to, like, drive, you know, get better field position, less energy it takes to get down the field, closer we are to scoring. And on defense, you know, we can keep them out of our territory and – defense can go stop them and switch offense.
And then, you know, Statesboro, everything was so wet. I'm going to get Aiden in here real quick also. Aiden and Thomas, don't go nowhere, Thomas. I got one more question for you. But Aiden Stein, real quick, talk about, you know, your thought process as a kicker. There's always a thought process you go through, but when the ground's soaking wet, do you think – I always think about the plant foot. I mean, that plant foot, it's either going to hit or it's not when it's that wet. I mean, talk about that.
I mean, whenever I'm about to go kick with my plant foot when it's wet, I always just try to stay light on my feet, you know. I try to prevent slipping and just try to kick the ball like I normally do.
Yeah, so it's basically just the same process, and you just hope you don't slip.
Yeah.
And it's got to be cool with, you know, Richmond Hill being, you know, kicker you, so to speak, with some guys. You know, you got a kid at Maryland's name slips on mine now, but in Petrino, Petrino at Maryland. He's had himself an early great season, and Britton Williams broke a record in his very first game at Georgia Southern and has had a good season so far. That's got to feel good knowing that you're in those shoes.
Yeah, I'm just really trying to live up to the expectations of the people who are in front of me, how well they've done, how much success they've had in the past, and I'm just trying to do everything that I can to fill up their shoes.
Awesome, awesome. All right, now, Thomas, one more question for you, man. Do you really eat some raw steaks? I mean, is that true? I know you eat the Caveman Pizza now since a couple weeks ago, but have you really eaten a raw steak?
Nah.
Oh, that's the honest to goodness truth. Oh, man. I mean, and I see Father Zimbro over there. He's like, ah. But, hey, you know, live on the radio, there's people that know. So, kudos to you. We'll go ahead and bring Hayden McCullough and Todd Goldrick in here for a few moments. You know, Hayden, I know.
We need to ask Hayden what he did to that hair before we talk any football. I mean, you say you listen to Low Country, you get more than just football. What happened to your hair? Like, You got a. I'm trying to think who he looked. He said Goldilocks. No, he looks like Trevor Lawrence without the long hair. Is that fair? What look were you going for?
Hey, Sunshine, I don't care.
Oh.
keep skying for his 19-yard post.
Did you lose a bet,
man?
He's going for that Karate Kid look.
He's going for the Karate Kid look.
Go ahead and tell us what you did to your hair.
I don't know. I just need hair that matches my personality on the team. Like a little bit crazy, but it's still out there.
Oh, okay.
I like it. But, you know, in all seriousness, Hayden, you know, one of the things that I've noticed about you from that receiving core is you catch a lot of balls over the middle. You got to be tough, not have alligator arms and, you know, eyes going out either corner.
Yeah, I mean, it's tough doing it. I mean, I'll take a couple hits there and here and there. I mean, it's fun, though. Those guys are flying around. I like hitting people. That's why I play defense, too. It's just Ty delivering the ball in the right spot and me getting ready to take the hit.
Yeah, the other night, you had one touchdown catch, we heard earlier, a total of four catches, 44 yards. So you're eyeing people down once you get that ball to take people out. Are you mainly talking about on the defensive side of the ball?
Can you repeat that?
Are you – yeah, that was my I haven't eaten yet, and I'm hungry, and I just took a drink really quick. I'm just going to stop right there before I say anything else. But you talk about you wanting to hit people. Obviously, that's going to go true for the defensive side of the ball. But then, I mean, is it something that you take pride in on the offensive side of the ball? You get the ball and you're looking to take somebody out? Because some running backs have that mentality. I can remember Kevin Harris at Bradwell. And he still does it at South Carolina. He's the second leading rusher in the SEC last year. And that was one of the things he does. And he'll tell you it's a numbers game for him. Yeah, he loves running over people, but for him it was just as much. If I know I can look for somebody in the hole on that buck sweep and take them out of my own, that's less guys for my guys to be able to block. And, I've never heard that before, but coming from a kid like that means a lot. Is that something you take some pride in?
I mean, absolutely. When coaches are calling crack blocks on linebackers where they're not seeing me coming, it's just fun to just go blow it up and protect our tight ends coming out to the flats. Just good. A fun time.
Right. So, hey, turnabout's fair play, right?
So you want them wide receivers with a linebacker mentality?
Yeah.
Is that
much.
How you can describe? Is that how we can
I mean, I can see your eyes are kind of going back and forth.
I mean, I will say, no offense, but you look more like a linebacker than a receiver. Is that fair for me to say?
Definitely.
Okay.
Well, you know, every great offense has one or two of the guys like that on offense at the skill positions that got a little crazy eye in them, and you give them the ball, you never know what's going to happen as long as they run the right direction. They're good.
So are you a possession receiver or are you just an all-around type receiver? What would you consider? Or you're not a burner, are you?
No.
You're not going to burn by nobody. You're more of a possession
I mean, type. Work I like to say I'm all around, but other people describe me definitely a possession receiver.
Okay.
And Ty, it's got to be fun throwing to a group of receivers like that. Even Ravon Grant, he had a great night the other night. He had that touchdown pass that we heard earlier at 143 yards on. Well, it's sitting right here in front of me. Why don't I just use it? 143 yards, 9 catches, and a score. Yep, I was correct. 16-yard average. And then you know, 24 for 33, 279 yards, 11.5 a pass. Two touchdown passes, and I know one of the things you've got to take a lot of pride in. You had a little trouble with the pick there for a couple games in a row, but no picks. I know you got to take some pride in that.
I just can't be making silly turnovers like throwing interceptions like that, and that's just something I've been working on this past couple weeks is just making sure I'm more accurate and just not making stupid decisions like I was this first couple weeks.
What was the difference between the first half and the second half? Because when the rain started coming, I said that, okay, that rain is going to cool Ty Goldrick off, and I'll be damned if you didn't make me eat those words. I mean, I put my foot right in my mouth because you come out hot the second half, but what was the difference between the first half and the second half as far as the weather goes?
I just think I had to take a little bit of time to get used to the weather and, like, the difference in the ball because it obviously does make a big difference. But then once I found it out, like, figured it out, that was – it was just like normal, just throwing and catch.
And then I know one of the things we said on air, and we were kind of taking up for you guys, you had those two or three balls slip through our hands in that second half. It's just one of those things. Sometimes it's just one of those things. You can't really talk about technique or you should have done this, you should have, could have, would have. It just happened. And I know there's probably some folks that, well, why didn't he go under center? Blah, 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 blah. And we took up for you guys that night on air. If you listen to the game recording, that'll be up tomorrow night. You'll hear us talk about it. Look, no. Stop it. If you're thinking that, don't worry about it. Forget that stuff. Because, hey, you do go under center on the last couple possessions late in the game, and you need to score. That just throws you into a different rhythm and timing. Talk about the difference in your rhythm and timing going from under center from the gun.
Do you even play under center?
No, we don't.
I'm saying in general, talk about what it would do to your timing if you were going from under center to what you do in the gun.
Well, I mean, under center is obviously, you know, people think you're going to run it more, and then you come out with like a play action maybe every once in a while. But definitely in the gun, you know, you're going to throw it more, obviously. But I don't really think it makes that big of a difference because you can do what you want whenever you want, however you want to. You just got to be good at it.
So. Can you do a 3-5 and 7-step drop?
I could if I needed to.
From the shotgun?
I don't need to.
You know, that's why I'm saying the shotgun. You ain't got to do those 3-5 and 7-step drops.
I can if I need to, but.
Okay. So you can play from under center.
Yeah.
Okay.
Then the last couple plays of the ball game, that was where the confidence kind of comes in that we can finish off drives and tight situations. Okay, it was just, you know, the balls that just they were perfect teardrop throw, balls under pressure from 25, 30 yards out. I mean, it was really, we talked about it too, up until that drive and those last three or four plays, Statesboro had not, they really hadn't brought the blitz at all, but they did just at the right time. But you were still able to get the ball out and throw a couple perfect teardrop passes. And again, Mother Nature decided to just play havoc in that second half. It was just balls that kind of went through our hands at the end. But I don't want to talk about the incomplete part of it, but I do want to talk about it had to make you feel good that under pressure you could put the ball in the right place.
Yeah, well, I mean, I already knew they were coming. It was a big down. We were in a big situation. We were in the red zone. And so, I mean, when we go out in like a wide, three wide, four wide, five wide, you know, I know they're gonna blitz, and I just got to be ready for it. Sit in the pocket and just deliver the ball.
Gotcha. Well, thanks, guys, for joining us. Our players of the games, we got some certificates over here. I'm gonna try to get them to you in a break here, but anyway, thanks for joining us, guys. Good luck on Friday night. We'll take a short commercial break, and we come back. And we'll talk just a few minutes with Coach Lezotte about who we got on Friday night. We'll be right back. You're listening to Coach's Show on LowcountryRadio.com, powered by these guys.
The Cats win big, and so should you. For 13 years at Exclusive Engravings on Ford Avenue, Chris and LaShonda Hartley have a wide range of gifts, trophies, executive awards, home accessories, custom apparel, and more. A veteran-owned business, Chris and LaShonda have served our country, and now they're ready to serve you. Trust local, shop local. Stop by to see Chris and LaShonda today. And oh yeah, Chris is a proud Batesburg-Leesville High School grad in South Carolina, just like Charlie Moon and longtime Richmond Hill teacher Sarah Goldrick.
And we're back on LowCountryRadio.com. We've got head coach Matt Lezotte with us again. We're going to talk a little bit about these Effingham County Rebels. You know, Effingham County comes in 3-1 on the night. I'll tell you what, let's do first. Let's touch on the region standings to kind of set the overall picture here. Because as most people know, I talked to somebody the other day, we still got 5 teams in the region, right? Nope, wrong. There's 7 teams in the region as of last year. We added South Effingham and Statesboro last year. So right now, region standings are Effingham County's in that first slot at 2-0 in the region, 3-1 overall. Statesboro 1-0 in the conference play. Brunswick, number 5, number 6 team in the state, depending on what poll you look at. They're 2-0 in conference play, and they're undefeated, 6-0 in the season. Glen Academy 1-1, Richmond Hill 1-1 in conference play. Then 6-7 are Bradwell 0-2, and South Effingham 0-2. And I still confidently believe that either Bradwell or South Effingham is going to jump up and clip somebody somewhere around game 8, 9, or 10, somewhere in there. I've been saying that, and at this point, I hope they do.
Hope it's not 10.
Right, because that's what we got.
10. They're 9, hour 10.
Right, gotcha.
If they can win any other week, they won't.
I hear you. Effingham County, they come in 3-1 on the year so far. And, you know, it's something interesting here. I got three? Say that again?
And 1-0 in the region.
Okay. Oh, 1-0 in the region. Yep. Okay. Max Preps, appreciate it. Appreciate it, Max Preps. They're technically right now. Well, I guess right now, technically, then Brunswick would be in first place because they are they're two and oh in conference play so far. Effingham County, and I just see them. They literally must have just gone online. I asked head coach John Ford for stats and roster earlier this week, and he's one of the other coaches we do a recorded show with, about a 20-minute short, much shorter version than this. And it was pretty interesting. He was being real mum's the word, and then all of a sudden I asked him again today, and I was like, hey, look, it'll really help us out, and blah, blah, blah. I was pleading with him. Lo and behold, I see some stats online for Effingham. So, hey, you know, we could talk about stats all we want in Effingham County, but they're a different team now than they were last year.
Well, their stats are irrelevant. You know, it all depends on – it's like ours are. It all depends on the week of preparation. The team that shows up on a Friday night, they're playing better football than they did last year. A lot of that has to do with the guys that they have being a year older and just used to playing competitive football. But, you know, they've been able to put together some wins this year, which has been good for them. But You know, I care more about what we're doing and less about what they're doing and making sure that we're executing on our end. I know that they're going to be prepared. Coach Ford is a good coach, and he'll have those guys prepared. And you know, we're gonna match it on Friday night.
There's one common opponent on schedule. That's one thing you look at when you're preparing. I know from a coaching staff standpoint, I don't know, every now and then you might check out some common opponents, maybe. I think that comes in. I think that really comes into play much more in basketball because you play so many games, and you might play common opponents two, three, four times. When in football, maybe not. You might look at some game film to get you some idea, but score, I know from y'all's standpoint, it really doesn't matter that much. From a broadcaster's standpoint, it means a lot because I can look at things and compare them. But, you know, just on paper, you know, they opened the season at home and lost to Buford 24-3. And then we all know what happened in our game, a 28-8 loss that was really, I mean, COVID, we're not going to talk about the COVID thing anymore, but you know, it was what it was. I mean, do you take anything away from their game with Buford?
They didn't play him without a quarterback.
Okay. All right, I'll just leave it right there. Drop the mic. Let's move on. Hey, and then you know, last week it was kind of shocking to me that they held South Effingham scoreless. I know South Effingham struggled a little bit, but when I recorded their show yesterday, one of the things Coach Nate Clark mentioned was that their opponents, and I knew their schedule was tough, but their opponents this year so far have a combined record of 21-1. I was like, whoa, I didn't, when you look at the schedule, yes, sir, you're right. So it shocked me that Effingham County was able to hold South Effingham to a goose egg last week.
Yeah, well, you know, and Coach Clark does a good job on offense. He's got a tremendous background as offense coordinator, but you know what? And it was another thing too, where just missed opportunities. You know, dealing with young teams. I think a lot of the teams in our region are fairly young. Effingham has a lot of older guys on there, and some of these other teams, Brunswick has some older guys, Glenn has some older guys, but there are a lot of teams that have a lot of new faces. Still trying to figure things out, figure out their identity, and I think it's a true case of that. I think Effingham's probably found theirs a little bit better than South Effingham has, and all of us are still trying to round out and put our foot on the gas here in the thick of things in our region play.
Well, we're going to take a commercial break now, and when we come back, we got a special guest joining us. And, hey, I don't know if the McDonough family is listening. Adam McDonough is one of the young men on the Richmondville football team. But Adam, or one of Adam's friends or next-door neighbors, go knock on his door. Tell him to turn the radio on. We got a special guest coming up right after this break. We'll be right back, folks.
Quality Contracting, 912-656-0968. When Noah sails the ark through your yard, call Robbie Oglesby with A-plus Quality Contracting for all your seamless gutter and roofing needs. Opening our doors in 2004, we offer over 30 years of experience, and we promise we're going to treat you right. We love our community and are proud sponsors of several RHHS sports programs. Mention you heard our ad on Low Country Radio and get 10% off a full home gutter installation. Call 912-656-0968 or see us at aplusquality.biz. That's aplusquality.biz. 912-656-0968. Let us get you covered for all your roofing and gutter needs. Geo Vista is not just a credit union. Geo Vista is a local community sponsor, a financial partner, and an educator for our youth of tomorrow. People helping people is Geo Vista's commitment to our members and the communities we serve. Geo Vista offers checking, savings, auto and mortgage loans, and more. Their mobile app and website allows you to manage your accounts from the convenience and comfort of home. Get started by going to geovistacu.com. We'll make it easy for you to become a partner and member.
At Richmond Hill Pharmacy, our goal is a healthier you and a healthier community. To keep you healthy, we fill most prescriptions in minutes, not hours. And with our HealthMinder prescription refill program, we'll personally call you when refills are ready, and we'll contact your doctor for renewals. We also offer free blood pressure screening and medication counseling, and can administer some vaccinations. Plus, we have diabetic and medical equipment, breast pumps, compression hosiery, a wide variety of over-the-counter medications, and much more.
At Richmond Hill Pharmacy, we can help keep your wallet healthy too with our Family Pharmacy Rewards Program. Enroll today and start earning points on your purchases and get 100 bonus points. That's a $5 value just for signing up. Visit us today at any of our three locations, Richmond Hill Pharmacy in Town Center, Hinesville Pharmacy across from Liberty Regional Medical Center, or Medical Center Pharmacy at Memorial. Online at richmondhillpharmacy.com. It's like having a pharmacist.
We're back on the Coach's Show on lowcountryradio.com, and I gave everybody fair warning. We're going to have a special guest later on tonight, and I teased it again right before this break. And then I told everybody, hey, if you know the McDonough's, go to the house, call them, tell them to hurry up, and tell the family to log on, get on air and listen. I don't know if Jack knew that we were going to be talking to his dad, Adam McDonough. How's it going, Mr. McDonough?
Hey, Daddy, how you doing, man? Thanks for having me.
Doing great. CW4, and I'm gonna get Mr. McDonough to explain what the heck CW4 is in just a minute. CW4, Adam McDonough, 28 years active duty, a Black Hawk instructor pirate, man, that ain't no joke. Stationed in Germany, Korea, Fort Hood, Hunter Army, Airfield Base in Savannah, two tours in Iraq, two tours in Afghanistan, and awarded two medals and a Bronze Star recipient. And I'm sure Adam McDonough will tell us that better than all that is he's a dad. His son is Jack. Adam, tell us where you are right now. And Coach Zott's here with us. I know you didn't want him to know something, but I guess you just kind of told him, but hey, you're going to miss the game. You're going to miss the game on Friday, but at least you'll be able to tune in and listen to us.
Absolutely. On the show, I'll definitely be tuned in, and that will be standard call number 87.
We're going to get him ready. Don't you worry about it.
Hey, those coaches out with us. You know, real quick, your coaches out. It's got to be when I moved to the Savannah area. When I was at Bradwell, started there, and what I heard from a lot of folks in that area was, hey, one of our main issues is, and one of the reasons why we're kind of struggling is because we're near a military base, and we've got kids that move in and out all the time. And I always thought, I never really said anything to anybody. I was a new guy, and I tried to be careful. You know, I want to make friends and not run them off before I get to make them. But, you know, there's this crazy thing called Air Force Base, Warner Robins. And it's so – it works. Coach Lezotte, talk about how cool it is to have the genes that come from a military family, the discipline and the routine that those guys have.
Well, I tell you, the most unique part of it is their ability to adapt. And we see guys that move in all the time that catch on really fast. And they have ability to fit in immediately. They're used to some of the newness that comes along with the moving that's required with the profession, and those guys are able to adapt and get after it, and that's probably their greatest attribute as far as those families go.
You know, Mr. McDonough, 28 years active duty, a Black Hawk instructor. How old were you when you became a Black Hawk instructor? I mean, I'm just saying that phrase, Black Hawk instructor, and I'm getting some chills, and I'm talking to somebody that instructs people how to fly machines that I only see in movies. How cool is that, number one, and how old were you when you got that role?
Charlie, I'm really fortunate for what I do. I love what I do. When I went to high school, I was a young enlisted man after college in high school football myself. And I enlisted in 1992. But I went to high school about 10 years later and became an instructor pilot in 2008. I had an opportunity to talk with Coach Lezotte and his staff. It was a couple years ago, but I was just jumping out of my seat. I was pretty nervous to tell Coach Lezotte. He really came past my high school coaches had on me. And actually, you know what I do now, I couldn't tell you how much the skills, the buy-in, the process, the built and learn kind of mentality that I needed to do what I do in the Army today. So I don't know if Coach Lezotte has ever talked about
that,
but I tell you what, I have blessed Jerry and Billy's staff about the years. I met Coach Lezotte and goes into the Phoenix Strikes, you know, a place like Iraq and Afghanistan. And I'll tell you what, I love what Coach Lezotte and the whole staff goes into our young men, you know, Monday through Sunday. And Charlie, one last thing, I know it may be an impact on me, but I don't know if anybody can appreciate what getting a group of 15 to 18 year old young men to stay focused and to buy into a process like he's done. I just can't say enough about our coaching staff and our community and how they work with these young men.
Well, let me follow that up. Adam, you beat me to the punch. I was gonna tell that story, you know, just about the leadership portion of it and the organization that goes into to executing a plan. And we really appreciate that. And it stirred up a thought process and a communication process within our staff that really made us look at things a little bit differently. And I'm forever grateful for that, and I appreciate those kind words. But you're a piece of that puzzle that makes this thing work, and a vital part of our success and our team's success is the positive reinforcement and support from our parents, understanding what we go through and what we do, and he's just one of those guys that did it, and I'm very grateful for that.
Yo, Mr. McDonough, before we let you go, just tell us I'm not gonna tell you. You can talk as long as you want. You serve this country. I don't care. You can talk as long as you want. But tell us, just in general, you know, what it's like to have been served our country for so long. What you try to pass down to your kids with Richmond Hill football, especially Jack. You know, being on the field, it's just got to be an awesome feeling, number one. But tell us about your role and what got you in the military, then your feelings on it. I mean, from the heart, and then what you try to pass on to Jack. Did I lose you there, Mr. McDonough? Okay, yeah, I got you back now. Oh, you're good. Go ahead.
I wasn't forced into the military, but I probably lacked the maturity as a young man, so I joined the military, for a little bit of money and a little bit of adventure. But then, I might have been a late bloomer, but I tell you what, I really enjoyed it. It reminded me the brotherhood and the camaraderie. If anybody's ever watched The Band of Brothers, I couldn't agree with the premise more. And a lot like these young men do on a football team, you know, they do it for each other. And for about the last, or maybe the first 5 or 8, I was kind of holding down a job, but the last 20 years or so, I really the relationships, the places the Army has taken me, I've lived in 3 continents, and I dragged my family mercilessly around this globe. And I tell you what, when Jack got here in 2016, he put a big giant red flag with a big black G in the front yard, and he's like, "Dad, I have found my people. This is where I want to live." And so he was a Georgia Bulldog from about 30 days after we got here. But that's how I joined the Army. It's taken me a lot of places, and I'm certainly grateful. And
awesome. Well, thanks so much for joining us. And hey, you're gonna get a pretty cool shout out on Friday night. We love doing shout outs on the air. As long as I'm not doing them during the middle of the play, they usually work out well. But we'll be talking to you on air on Friday night. Hey, stay safe out there, and again, build the hill, and we'll talk to you on Friday night on the airwaves.
Hey, thank you, Charlie. I want one more thing. I tell you what, we'll talk to you earlier tonight before we went on the air, and I lost a trailer tire on this trailer I'm pulling. Was able to get the spare put back on, and broke down right next to a South Carolina
emergency contact team. So I don't know if we could say it on the air, but God is good and on time. And I appreciate you for having me.
Oh yeah. You could say that on there. You could say that on there. But thanks a lot for joining us. We'll talk to you Friday night. Stay safe. Again, that was CW4, Adam McDonough, and what he referenced South Carolina Emergency Management Teams, because he was talking. We were talking about college and that kind of thing earlier tonight, and we were testing out the phone system really quick. But I mentioned to him that Brock and I both grew up in South Carolina, and that Brock was a Clemson grad. I was a Carolina grad. Brock was a Clemson fan. I'm sorry, but of course I was raised a dog fan. But it's all good. It's all good. Right now, we're gonna keep it right here. And we're going to talk about something else that's a little bit on the serious side. And then after that, Coach Lezotte will be done. Later on the show, we'll be hearing from Eli Covington and on his picks. Because right now, the Kid Wonder is leading the contest. He's leading the contest, folks. So we're going to have to catch up with old Eli. We'll hear from him in a little bit. But right now, Coach Lezotte, we're going to talk about a pretty cool fundraiser that we're kind of kicking off. We're going to raise some money for Autism Awareness and Susan Komen Foundation.
Excited to partner up and get this thing kicked off. And, you know, especially Richmond Hill Football, Low Country Radio, we have a unique partnership and bond, and whatever we can do to try to prepare or try to serve the community a little bit better. Glad that you guys had the idea to come up with us partnering and making this happen.
Yeah, it was pretty cool how it happened. It all happened because I said something on social media that was, people took it a little bit differently than what I meant. So anyway, I made something fun out of it, and it's packed and jacked. So when you see packed and jacked on some Twitter and some Facebook things coming up, you'll know exactly what it is. We'll push the fundraiser out. It'll either be tomorrow night or Friday morning once we finalize the design. But you'll see that coming out. Buy the T-shirts. At the end of this month, we'll be cutting hopefully a big old fat check to Autism Awareness and Susan Komen Foundation. And for both of, you know, Coach Lezotte and myself, both of those organizations are close to my heart. Myself, because I've been a special ed teacher for now, 12, 13 years, and teaching an all autism class now. And my 5-year-old nephew was diagnosed with autism three years ago at this point. So that's close to my heart. And I know Coach Lezotte, Susan Komen Foundation is close to yours as well.
Absolutely. My wife, Lindsay, has her last treatment of chemo Friday, and
nice.
We're pretty fired up about it. Excited about what the road holds. She's been super strong, right for our family. You know, I get emotional thinking about how strong she's been, and you know, can't wait to raise awareness, provide some funds to a foundation that's got that at its roots. And you know, it was one of those things I asked her. I said, is there anything that you would think about? And that was the first thing that came out of her mouth. And I said, well, let's roll with it. You know, it's moved really fast, and it typically does, you know, and it affects all of us. Cancer affects all of us in some form or fashion. And, you know, she's been a beacon of light, a beacon of hope for whoever she's come in contact with. It's amazing to see the impact that she's had. She her strength is overwhelming, and it's really helped me be a better man, be a better husband, definitely be a better leader within our program. And so I'm forever grateful to that.
Yeah, kind of put football in perspective a little bit. Yeah, man.
Yeah, you know, I had my three kids up here running around a little earlier, and she came and snatched them up. And you know, it's one of those things where, you know, It definitely puts things in perspective. You know, we go play this sport, this game,
And you get paid for it.
And you get paid for it. You know, get to impact lives. And man, I got this woman next to me that's just impacting me more than she could ever imagine.
And probably your team too.
Oh, I think so. You know, I shared with them very early. You know, that there were some things going on back. It was just before we started spring football. They saw me on my phone a good bit, and I decided to share with them what was going on, and it's been a tremendous outpouring of support from the Richmond Hill community. for us and for her and my family and especially my Wildcat family.
Well, there's absolutely no way to segue into the next segment, which the next segment will be our college picks contest, and then Brock and I'll kind of round things out. There's really no good way to segue into that, so we're going to take a short break, and we come back. We're going to switch gears and talk about our college picks for just a moment. We'll be right back, folks.
The Cats win big, and so should you. For 13 years at Exclusive Engravings on Ford Avenue, Chris and LaShonda Hartley have a wide range of gifts, trophies, executive awards, home accessories, custom apparel, and more. A veteran-owned business, Chris and LaShonda have served our country, and now they're ready to serve you. Trust local, shop local. Stop by to see Chris and LaShonda today. And oh yeah, Chris is a proud Batesburg-Leesville High School grad in South Carolina, just like Charlie Moon and longtime Richmond Hill teacher Sarah Goldrick.
We're back on LowCountryRadio.com. Brock and I will spend more time talking about this after Coach Lezotte gets the kids back to the house. And back holding on to that football. As soon as y'all walked in the door, Coach Lezotte, I said, don't fumble the football. And your daughters kind of looked at me like, he knows the secret too.
That's right. That was pretty cool.
Right.
That's
but they get to pay for Coach Dragon. They going to pay for Coach Dragon one day.
Oh, yeah.
You got to teach you how to say Dragon.
Yeah, I can't wait to have Coach Dragon on again soon. I know their season kicks off either Thursday.
Okay. That's good.
Thursday. I knew it was soon, this week or next week. We're going to touch real quick on our – or next Thursday. Touch real quick on our college picks contest right now. We'll hear from him after this next break. The kid wonder, Eli Covington's father-son knows best. You can see more information about them on our website, which will kick off tomorrow night. We're kind of timing that with the onset of the fundraiser for different reasons. And so that with our LowCountryRadioSports.com website, it's actually up now, but we hadn't publicized it much because there's not much on it. But by tomorrow night, all the coaches' shows from Effingham County, South Effingham, Bradwell, and, of course, your Richmond Hill Wildcats will all be on there. I'll have some game highlights. Our game recordings will be on there in an archive. You can save that. We got a Twitter feed from a couple different places. We'll have a couple other shows linked up there from a couple other media outlets that I greatly respect. And some other fun stuff that I'm just going to leave that hanging out there and just be a surprise for you. And this is one of the fun things we'll have on there. The college picks contest on Coach's show, I don't know. But right now, again,
the pigskin pick 'em.
There you go. Pigskin pick 'em. There you go. Boom. You just named it at 8:22 on 10-6-21. But right now, hey, Coach Lezotte, who you got? Who's putting in the picks for the football coaches? Is it somebody different every week, or do you even know?
I don't know who it was this week. It was probably Chad Blanton.
Chad Blanton, because you guys didn't do so well last week. I want to say it was like two. It was either 2-5 or 3-4. I guess 3-4 is not horrible.
Then it was Coach Davis's fault.
Coach Davis. He just left, so it's all good to say that. Unless he's got his team on. I hear you. This week it's a few pretty big games. Quick. First thought. I'm not going to go through all of them, Coach Lezotte, but quick thoughts. UGA minus 15 at Auburn.
I think they're. It's tough to bet against them, man.
Yeah.
The champions.
And apparently that's what your rep says, too. Whoever put it in for the coaches.
Yeah, the players didn't do it.
Right, yeah, the players didn't put theirs in. They didn't put theirs in, so they will just default to the favorites.
No, you're good.
Oh, I thought you were about to chime in there. Oklahoma, minus 3.5. Neutral site, of course, the Red River Rivalry taking on the Horns.
It's going to be as good as it's been in years, I believe. But I think Oklahoma is going to have a little more jazz there at the end.
All right, and here's one I know you probably have studied greatly, and I put this in there kind of as a joke, but I was just curious to see. UConn. -3.5 playing UMass.
I don't know. UConn seems to be on fire right now, but you know what?
They're bringing the knowledge.
Yeah, but you know what? Like, I would pick UMass.
That's who I
would pick. That's UMass. What I pick. I think UMass might cover straight up. Just
yeah, that's
let's go get it,
Chris. The big
Winky?
No, not Winky.
I played with the guy at UMass's. field. Okay, they have a huge wall behind the end zone. I don't know if you're familiar with that. Play with a guy, Trey Townsend, legend. Some of the biggest hands I've ever seen. He was an amazing college linebacker, football player, played quarterback in high school. Saw him stand flat-footed at the 50-yard line and throw the ball, and it landed and hit about halfway up that wall.
Good gracious.
Yeah, I was like, okay, Hail Mary, he gets it. Big throw from anywhere on the field.
Good gracious.
I'll see you stand flat-footed and throw the ball almost 40 yards just flicking it before it came or something.
It was probably a couple years ago.
No, it was this year because I commented on the radio.
Old rotator cuff getting out.
Get a little adrenaline on Friday nights.
Chris Berman's guy's looking at. He's an old UMass grad. One more.
Chris Berman from ESPN?
Yeah.
He went to Brown.
Okay, yeah. No, actually, you are correct on that. There's something he did with.
Because he had always talk about Brown. Ain't just, no Brown
right.
guy.
That's right. No, you're right. You're right. There's something he did with UMass. I don't know. That came out of left field. Anyway, I'm just going to move on. One more. Alabama minus 17 at Texas A&M.
Tough to bet against Alabama too, man. But, you know, like I said last time, I got a lot of love for the Aggies. So, I think they're going to cover.
You didn't ask him about Notre Dame and his favorite, Rocket Ismail.
Notre Dame's going to cover.
Okay.
Notre Dame, minus one at Virginia Tech.
Yeah, it ain't even going to be that close.
Okay. All right, did you when you were at JMU, did you guys play Vautech at all?
Yeah, we played. I'll never forget shaking hands with Nathaniel Deeby at midfield for captains and it feeling like a crop of bananas hitting my forearm like his
Vautech. Y'all played Vautech?
Yeah, we
what was it like going up against that well-coached defense?
Hey, listen, it wasn't about going up against the defense. It was about going up against that inner Sandman. Really? They didn't warn us. They didn't warn us that was happening. And I was like, what the hell is it going on? And they started bouncing. I was like, okay. What's about to happen right here?
Let's go get him, dude.
D'Angelo Hall was on that team.
Okay. Oh, yeah.
He picked me off. He broke off the hash, man, the college hash. And, I mean, I threw a rocket to the field, a deep out, and he toe-tapped and picked it off, man. What a great player he was.
Oh, yeah.
Yep. He went on to have a pretty good career in the NFL and spent some time with the Falcons. But any last thoughts for Wildcat Nation before you head out? And Brock and I are going to hang out and talk about some of this a little bit and then around our thoughts about it. Richmond Hill coming up next week, but I know you're getting out in a second. Last thoughts.
Dealing with that packed and jacked philosophy, man. Let's pack the house Friday night.
Yes, sir.
You saw how the turnout helped us last Friday. These guys have been putting in a lot of effort, a lot of energy, a lot of emotion. In preparation, not only just for the season, but this week especially. Military Appreciation Night, Friday night. It's going to be WSAB Game of the Week. There's a lot of attracting folks to this game. Cross River rivalry with Effingham. Everybody in our region's a rival of ours nowadays. But, I couldn't be more proud of our guys. It matters to them to represent Richmond Hill, represent the community out there on that field. Come check them out. Come support them. Love them up. They're gonna have a great night Friday night. Build the hill.
Awesome. Just like we always do. Anything's out with Coach Lezotte. Build the hill. We'll take a short commercial break, and we come back. We'll hear from the Wonder Kid, Eli Covington. You're listening to the Coach's Show on LowCountryRadio.com, powered by the folks across the parking lot, Chris and LaShonda Hartley at Exclusive Engravings, and the folks right here in this neighborhood, Papa's Pizza.
The Cats win big, and so should you. For 13 years at Exclusive Engravings on Ford Avenue, Chris and LaShonda Hartley have a wide range of gifts, trophies, executive awards, home accessories, custom apparel, and more. A veteran-owned business, Chris and LaShonda have served our country, and now they're ready to serve you. Trust local, shop local. Stop by to see Chris and LaShonda today. And oh yeah, Chris is a proud Batesburg-Leesville High School grad in South Carolina, just like Charlie Moon and longtime Richmond Hill teacher Sarah Goldrick.
Well, we're back on lowcountryradio.com waiting on the Wonder Kid, Eli Covington, to come in. But our last segment of the show, Brock, will be after this segment, and we'll just round things out with our thoughts on Richmond Hill football in general, their first half of the season, and outlook going into Friday night. But before we do that, I'm going to have a little fun with his college picking contest. I see you got your theirs in this week. You got faith. You got, whoa, hey, we got a caller. We got a caller. The Wonder Kid, I think, is calling. Let's see who we got here. Yeah, we got him. Hey, Eli Covington, are you on the line, my man? Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Hey, and you got to feel pretty good. You got to feel just great because you started off with our pick'em contest, a couple weeks ago, and was 7-3 that first weekend. What did you end up this past weekend?
I think I got 6-4, and I think I had that 6-4. So we got to stay safe.
So anybody that understands how all this works, if you're 7-3 and then 6-4, I mean, that's if my math is correctly, 13-7. I mean, if you consistently do that, you and your dad Matt and your mom Hillary and your sister, you guys are gonna have to move out west.
Yeah, to Vegas. Yeah.
This week, real quick. This week, let's see, the toughest. There's some tough ones on the board this week. Well, if you're looking at one game that you thought, man, that's the toughest one for me to make a pick on, which one was it?
Oh, it's definitely gonna be Ole Miss and Arkansas. Two strong SEC teams, but coming off a huge loss to Georgia and Alabama, so it's gonna be a tough one.
So who did you go? Well, I'm looking at the sheet right now. You went with
Arkansas.
Okay, Arkansas. All right, went against the grain a little bit there. You talking? All right. Hey, that Red River rivalry. Who you got in that one?
I got Oklahoma. They obviously they're not looking strong, but neither is Texas this year, to be honest. So I got Oklahoma in this one.
All right. Now, what'd you think about that UConn UMass game? Were you looking at that one, going, "What in the world did Charlie Moon put that one on there for?"
Yeah, I actually kind of wanted to rewind and put that one on there.
Who'd you go with in that game?
I'm gonna do UConn.
All right, again, thanks for joining us, Eli, and we'll talk to you next week.
Thank you.
Again, that was Kid Wonder, Eli Covington. And we'll have more of him and his dad, Matt, and why they're involved in the program. More of that will be on our website, which will kick off. Like I said, the website's already up, lowcountryradiosports.com. You can go there right now and listen to some of the coaches' shows from all over the conference. Over the past 4 or 5 weeks, but by tomorrow night, everything will be up, all of the coaches' shows, and then Father Knows Best for Matt and Eli, their story and why it's important to me and important to some folks in South Carolina, and we included them in this contest. You'll find out more about that. We have some fun things. Chips Chalk is going to be on the website, his views and thoughts from the previous weekend in college football. We're going to do some fun things starting next week with some Richmond Hill football fans. We'll have the shout-out line. Actually, everything up until now will be on there, from shout-out calls. The Zimbalotti's are still in the house here at Papa's Pizza. They got a crew that's called in. Probably, I want to say, 4 or 5 different folks that have called in. But don't forget about that, folks. 912-250-4841. 912-250-4841. And the beauty of that is you're just giving awesome shout-outs to, you know, Richmond Hill and Wildcat Nation. Especially, hey, look, that record on paper right now, you know, is 1-4. But, Brock, it's not your average 1-4 team. Hey, just like the other night when I was eating a turkey sandwich, it was I can't remember the exact play, but Hayden McCullough made a big catch, and he came down with it, and you could tell I had a turkey and cheese sandwich in my mouth. I was trying to walk this, but, you know, 1-4. We're really only a missed PAT at Burke County and a couple wet paws when Mother Nature just changed the game, Statesboro, the other loss was a tight one too. Really, the only game that got away from us was Northside.
Yeah, I tell you one thing. Talking to Coach Lezotte, he and I was talking off the air. a little bit. He was talking about how this team has just gotten no breaks all year long. The rain Friday. I mean, simple things like losing your best lineman literally the first play of the season.
You're talking about Hubbard.
Yeah, getting COVID already at the beginning of the season. The rain coming out. Supposed to rain Friday night. And I don't care how good you are. If you're going to have a successful season, you got to catch breaks. I mean, everything's got to fall in. You know, you got to have some, the opponent miss some field goals. You got to have a fumble here, a fumble there. You got to have the ball bounce your way. You know, I don't care how good Alabama is, Clemson, when they, the years they win a national championship, they always come across a couple of close games and they always get lucky. And it just seemed like that Richmond Hill just don't have any, they got the talent. He was talking about how good football they played. They got the talent. It's just they're not catching breaks. You know, just like Richmond Hill fumbled the ball twice. Three, he said, I know it twice, three times, and the ball just ran right to State, bounced right to Statesboro. Whereas Statesboro put the ball on the ground two times in the second half, but one went out of bounds, if I'm correct.
That's right. Right in front of us, aligned with us.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and then another one bounced right back to Statesboro. Mm-hmm. So, you know, you take, if they bounce, you know, one, you know, a different way, Richmond Hill could be, you don't get COVID, you don't lose Hubbard. You know, they could easily have just one loss. I mean, Northside was, I don't know if Richmond was quite ready for a Northside yet. They will be in a couple more weeks. But, you know, I picked Richmond Hill to win conference. I'm still sticking with that. Even though I haven't seen Brunswick, haven't seen Effingham. South Effingham, I don't know what's going on down there. I'm not going to lie to you. I was not impressed with Bradwell. Okay? Like, I mean, I wasn't impressed with them from nothing, okay? Mm-hmm. And I know you are.
No, and I don't disagree with you as far as the play on the field. Yeah, there's not a whole lot different. I just know what's been there in the past and the effort and the support and all that. My biggest point about Bradwell is their effort is going to be there from start to finish. They're going to be tough. They're going to make you work hard. And that's kind of different than some of the teams in the past. I think, even, you know, Coach Brock might say, hey, we might be a year away or 2 years away from being, you know, where you want to be. He don't want to hear that because I know he wants to get W's. But you're right. Right now, you know, on the field, they're struggling big time, kicking themselves in the foot. But you know, but I hear you.
Yeah. So I got Richmond Hill. I know you've been hyping up Brunswick. You know, they barely escaped Glenn Academies. I think it's anybody's region, and I really think a Richmond Hill. I understand we got their fifth now, but one victory, and they're tied with Effingham for the conference lead at 2-1. Wait a minute. No, didn't he say that's wrong?
Yeah, that's wrong. Effingham County is only 1-0. They played one conference game, and that was
last
South,
week.
Yeah, South Effingham.
Yeah, and they handled South Effingham 34-0. So, like I said, I'm still stick with Richmond Hill. They just need to catch a couple more breaks, and they'll be fine. And they've got to be one of the most improved teams in the state of Georgia from the first game till now. McCullough starting to come along. Goldrich is looking. I mean, I don't know if there's a better quarterback in the state playing better football than him right now.
Listen to Brock Vanet putting the statements out there.
I mean, you wouldn't agree.
Well, he's, I mean, it's hard to right say that because there's so many teams in the state of Georgia that are just. I mean, I know you didn't get to see Thomas Castellanos. And this is no disrespect to Ty Goldrick at all. And Ty Goldrick would probably tell you, hey, Thomas Castellanos. He's the freaking real deal. His game against us last year, I know you didn't get to see him then, but he came in this year as a preseason player of the year at 5A. His game against us last year put him on the map with teams such as Alabama, Clemson, and some other teams.
Now, I'm not talking about talent. I'm just talking about
upside.
No, how he's playing right now.
Okay.
You know, I mean, he's hot. He's a hot quarterback.
Oh,
what I meant was he might be – the hottest quarterback in the state. Not the most talented.
I got you.
Not the most, kind of like a hitter.
I got you.
You know, sometimes the best hitter in the, it's not Steve Trout or somebody, but anyway, I'm saying he's probably as hot as any quarterback in the state right now.
Yeah, I mean, just the other night, he was right up. I'm looking up his numbers really quick, but he had such a great night the other night. And then, like we talked to him, in some ways, it was kind of his coming out party a little bit. I mean, we knew what his upside was. Heck, I knew what his upside was last year. That's why I was so disappointed that he was a senior coming in this year. Then I realized about 4 or 5 weeks ago, about the beginning of the season, wait a minute, I'm wrong. No, he's just a junior, so that's great. So that worked out really well. He's going to have 2 years under the helm as long as he keeps working hard. But, you know, just the other night he had just over 300 yards passing, and half that ball game was played in the quagmire, and then getting the ball to their own 18-19-yard line with 93 seconds to go. Successful drive downfield. It didn't end like Richmond Hill fans wanted to, but he threw a couple teardrop balls under some serious pressure and put them in the perfect place. Ball was just slipped through a couple of our guys' hands, so that's got to give us a lot of confidence in tight situations.
I mean, he's the best quarterback in the conference, wouldn't you think? Well, I don't know. That boy from Statesboro, I know they're two different type of quarterbacks, but I would take either one of them under center.
Yeah, and I'll tell you, Brunswick's going to have something to say about that. They are almost running a three quarterback system with Way, Weatherspoon, and Ellis. Now, here's an interesting thought as we kind of round things out here in the next 5-10 minutes. Weatherspoon is a kid that transferred mid-year, Tommy Weatherspoon, from I can't remember where he came from, but he transferred to Brunswick mid-season, and lo and behold, he's playing, and he got in his first game at the end of the game the other night. So he may be a surprise. He's just now learning the system. But Ellis is their arm, 24-44, 351 yards. But my point is that they basically run a two quarterback system, and between the two of them, it's the Way and Ellis. They're going to be tough, and they've got playmakers on the outside. Reese Simmons, 311 yards on the ground with Simmons, and then they've got Jacoby Hill, 450 yards. They got their skill guys back from last year. Charlton, almost 200 yards on the ground, but they're going to be tough. But hey, first things first, we've got to take care of Effingham County. I know you hadn't seen much of Effingham County. Nobody really has, because their schedule hadn't been that difficult. But you can't say, I mean, 3-1, and they just beat a pretty good offense from South of Effingham, shut them out. So Effingham's going to be a challenge.
Yeah, and like I said, I don't know what to expect from Effingham. I know we had that coach on at the at the clinic, and I was very impressed by him. He's a man of faith. He's a very religious man. Can coach some football. So we gonna see. I tell you one thing. Coach Lezotte gave me the scout report against Statesboro last week. He said the quarterback's fast. He didn't say he was that fast. So I didn't get anything. So apparently nothing really stands out. Effingham County, like the quarterback for Statesboro, but like Coach Lezotte said, we just got to go down there and play Richmond Hill football, and we should come out there with a victory.
Yeah, it looks like they finally, literally, I was mentioning this earlier, they finally, literally, as of today, finally put stats on here. They weren't. Coach Ford was trying to keep his team quiet, and I kept begging him for it. Hey, I've been doing some coaches' shows with him, recorders. I guess that relationship is pretty strong. He finally did it. Matthew Ford, interestingly enough, he is the son of Yancey Ford, Effingham County superintendent. He comes in Friday night, 21 of 30, 226 yards, 10.8 a pass, and one touchdown, no picks, and he's averaging 226 yards a game in the air. Now, with him, from what I've heard from Coach Ford, he's no relation. Again, Matthew, the quarterback, is the son of Superintendent Yancey Ford. But John Ford, head coach, is really – he really likes what Matthew Ford's done, because he takes care of the ball. He doesn't – with his feet, when he gets flushed out of the pocket – a lot of times high school quarterback, and they get flushed out of pocket, they just take off. You know, like Michael the other night with Statesboro, but he was such an athlete. I mean, who could blame him? But Ford can be flushed out of the pocket, and he keeps his eyes upfield.
Yeah, the quarterback from Statesboro was coached to do that.
Yeah, you're probably right. Hey, if you first read it in there, we don't want you making mistakes. Just take off, big man, because you got the athletic ability, and he does, really quickly. Let me run down the Effingham County.
But one thing we need to keep an eye on Friday night is the weather. Coach Lezotte did say they're calling for rain again. So that's one thing that Richmond Hill fans need to be aware of. Be prepared for another what, Quagmire?
Quagmire.
Like Chris Berman used to say.
Yeah, Quagmire.
Yeah, it's not going to be the frozen tundra, but it might be kind of like a tundra or something Friday night.
Yeah, it might be nasty. Yeah. We're rounding things out here in the last couple minutes. Effingham County scheduled really quick. They lost at home to Buford 24-3. Now, they didn't have the COVID offense at Effingham County, but we did in a 28-8 loss to Buford. And if you remember in that game, it was a 14-8 game. Buford was up with like 6 minutes to go in the ball game, and we turned the ball over once, fumbled return for a touchdown, and then we fumbled again on another possession deep in our own territory, and Buford scored again. So we were neck and neck, and then with a true freshman playing quarterback that has not played quarterback in this offense before, in Caleb Easterling. Also on their schedule, 20-0 win against a bad Lakeside team. I don't care, I'll say it, a bad Lakeside team. Then a bad Howard team from making, yes, I can say that, 27-6 win over them. And then, you know, South Effingham, you might think they're a bad team because they're 1-4, but I don't think they're a bad team. I think they are similar to Bradwell in that they might be 1 year, maybe 2 years away. They've got tons of sophomores and juniors starting on South Effingham, and they got a good-looking young quarterback sophomore that's learning a lot in DeGenero, and they shut them out. I don't care who you're playing. You give them a goose egg, that means you're doing something right on defense. And another guy I've talked to, Jermaine Fields, he's a defense coordinator with the Effingham County middle school team, and he talked about the guys on the defensive side of the ball for Effingham. And there's a lot of guys that don't care about each other's numbers. They fly after the ball. They're not the biggest in the world. They got a couple beefy guys along the line, but their linebacking corps is just, you know, not that big. They lack some athleticism in the defensive backfield, but they fly to the ball. So really looking forward to that. Thanks for joining us. Thanks for joining us tonight on the Coach's Show. You've been listening to Coach's Show on LowCountryRadio.com, powered by Chris and LaShonda Hartley at Exclusive Engravings. I'm going to take a short break, and we come back, I'm going to round things out here from Papa's Pizza, and I'm going to tell John Cave, I don't know if he's got anything left. I'm going to try to get something to eat. We'll be right back after this commercial break to round things out.
The Cats win big, and so should you. For 13 years at Exclusive Engravings on Ford Avenue, Chris and LaShonda Hartley have a wide range of gifts, trophies, executive awards, home accessories, custom apparel, and more. A veteran-owned business, Chris and LaShonda have served our country, and now they're ready to serve you. Trust local, shop local. Stop by to see Chris and LaShonda today. And oh yeah, Chris is a proud Batesburg-Leesville High School grad in South Carolina, just like Charlie Moon and longtime Richmond Hill teacher Sarah Goldrick.
And we're back last segment here on LowCountryRadio.com. I'm Charlie Moon alongside Brock Vinay. And it's been a great night here. I wanted the show to be cut down to about an hour and 30 minutes total, but about 20 minutes over that. But we had a lot of quality discussion earlier. We had audio highlights mixed in and things like that, like I wanted. We got some real good insight from Coach Lezotte and some of the players based off some of the specific plays in that Statesboro game. So I was real good. I'm happy with that. I know you don't want to hear any more about the production of the Coach's Show, but I am going to round it out like this. Hey, show up and show strong. Show up strong on Friday night. With only 3 home games this season, this being game 2 of the 3 home games that we have, our last game of the regular season will be at home. I'm sorry. Back up, wrong schedule. I'm going to get there in just a second. But this is our second of 3 home games. And our third game is coming up later in the season. Show up. Be loud, folks. I can remember going back to the Valdosta game a couple of years ago. We were imploring fans to get up. It took a while. And then it did. About halfway through that fourth quarter, and especially on those last couple drives, and we were able to make some of the biggest defensive stops in Richmond Hill history, to be honest with you. And that was a great night, and it's continued from then. The Hill has been packed and jacked ever since then. Pay attention to that fundraiser that's coming out. It'll be out to tomorrow night or sometime Friday. We've been coinciding that with the launch of our website, lowcountryradiosports.com. But it was such a beauty tonight also to talk to CW4 Adam McDonough. He's the father of one of the young tight ends on the Richmond Hill roster, Jack McDonough. And Jack's seen some playing time on the field as a young tight end with the Cats, and his dad's on the road. He's not serving our country right this minute because he's going to a homecoming reunion, but he serves our country, and he has done so with pride for 28 years. It was such great to talk to him, wish him well out there. And I know we'll talk to him on the airwaves Friday night. And also at home, I know Serena and the girls, I don't know if they're listening right now, but I love you. I'll be home in about an hour and a half, and I know one of the things that sometimes we forget is our families with us and coaches, and I'm not going to compare year-round between what us and coaching staffs do, because coaching staffs in that off-season are jacked and packed all the time, but especially during season, the folks at home, they see me come in and out all the time, but they don't there's not a whole lot of discussion for a while, and they know that going into the season. They understand, what you lose, but sometimes it's really cool to have the opportunity to do what I'm about to do on air and say, I love you, Serena, I miss you, I want to give you a big old fat hug when I get home and a big old kiss on the cheeks, because I appreciate everything you do for me, the girls, the dogs, Russell and Pippa, and the cats. I don't know all the cats' names. I'll never be able to get them right. But we appreciate you. And whether you know it, Richmond Hill community appreciates you guys too, because, they know that for us to be able to support the community and the athletic program, Richmond Hill, that a lot of time missed there. So anyway, hey, don't go to sleep yet. Stay up or set your alarm. I'll be home in an hour and a half, and I'll give you a big old kiss. I love you. We'll talk to you later. Hey, Richmond Hill Nation, now that I'm done with that, you turn to somebody over the next 48 hours and tell them you love them too, and all that sappy talk stuff, and get ready to come packed and jacked on Friday night. We'll be on at 7 o'clock for the pregame show. So turn it on. Myself, Brock, and Chip, and I'm not sure where Tim and Freddie might be with us. I'm not sure, or they might be calling one of the Richmond Hill or the Lowcountry Radio games of the week. But thanks for joining us tonight. We've had a great time. We'll talk to you on Friday night.
The Cats win big, and so should you. For 13 years at Exclusive Engravings on Ford Avenue, Chris and LaShonda Hartley have a wide range of gifts, trophies, executive awards, home accessories, custom apparel, and more. A veteran-owned business, Chris and LaShonda have served our country, and now they're ready to serve you. Trust local, shop local. Stop by to see Chris and LaShonda today. And oh yeah, Chris is a proud Batesburg-Leesville High School grad in South Carolina, just like Charlie Moon and longtime Richmond Hill teacher, Sarah Goldrick.